Hello students, good morning to all of you. Today the topic which we are going to discuss is about an experiment, famous experiment, Stern-Gerlach experiment. Let us start, but before going to start the topic, we should know what is the purpose of the experiment, because every experiment has its own purpose. So here there must be a purpose. See here. Who did the experiment? Otto Stern and Walther Gerlach, these two scientists, in 1922. Performed experiment to confirm the existence of electron spin, okay, and associated magnetic moment. So this was the purpose of performing the experiment. If you do not understand, you may start from basic idea that in an atom, electrons revolve around the nucleus. Since electron is charged particle, so it constitutes an current loop. Obviously, magnetic field will be there. So, atom behaves as a teeny magnet. And due to orbital motion of the electron, magnetic moment is there. But later it was suggested that since electron not only revolves around the nucleus, but it also spins about its axis. So due to spin motion, an additional magnetic moment must be there. First thing. Second thing, classically it is believed that there is no any preferred direction, means it can spin in any of the orientation. There is no any preferred direction. But from quantum mechanical point of view, it was found that there must be a direction. So there must be a specified orientation, space quantization. So this fact was confirmed by Stern-Gerlach experiment. Okay, so in this experiment, when we talk about result, we will find that we get two separate lines instead of one line. Why two separate line except at ends? This is the thing which we are going to discuss in this question. So now, first we will see what is the principle of the experiment. The experiment is based on the behavior of a magnetic dipole, or you may say atomic magnet, in a non-uniform magnetic field. Mind it, you have to focus on this term, non-uniform magnetic field, means we will pass the atomic magnet through uniform magnetic field or non-uniform. But here, in this experiment, Stern and Gerlach passed the atomic magnet through non-uniform magnetic field. Why not through uniform? See here. In a uniform magnetic field B, द डाइपोल एक्सपीरियंसेस ए टॉर्क. यू हैव रीड अर्लियर दैट व्हेन ए डाइपोल इज सिचुएटेड इन ए यूनिफॉर्म मैग्नेटिक फील्ड द टू पोल एक्सपीरियंसेस इक्वल एंड अपोजिट फोर्स constituted torque, and this torque try to rotate the dipole to put the dipole in the direction of magnetic field. And same thing is here, in a uniform magnetic field B, the dipole experiences a torque that tends to align the dipole parallel to the field, because both the pole, north pole and south pole of atomic magnet experience equal and opposite force. If the dipole moves in such a field in a direction normal to the field, it will trace a straight line path without any deviation. So there is no question of deviation. This is all about classical point of view. But as I told you, Eastern and Gerlach did the experiment by considering non-uniform magnetic. So let us see what is the effect of non-uniform magnetic. Here, in an inhomogeneous magnetic field, the dipole experiences, in addition, a translatory force. As we saw, in uniform magnetic field, it experiences only torque. But when the same atomic dipole is placed in non-uniform magnetic field, it experiences torque as well as translatory force in addition. If the atomic magnet passes across such an inhomogeneous magnetic field, suppose atomic magnet is passed through an inhomogeneous magnetic field, then what will be result? It will be deviated away from its rectilinear path. Means the path along which it should go, actually it would not go, it will deviate from its original path. And how much will be the deviation? We can calculate through the mathematical expression. So mathematically we can see how much deviation and how much displacement. So all we are going to discuss with this mathematical part. Let the silver atom of magnetic moment M, when we say magnet, a magnet has two poles, north pole and south pole, and magnetic pole strength is generally denoted by P, similar to charge Q. As we know, there are two types of charge, positive charge and negative charge. Similarly, in a magnet, there are two poles equivalent to charge, plus Q, minus Q. No, here we denote them by plus P and minus P. So P is the pole strength, and suppose length of the dipole is L, then P into L, product of pole strength and length, is called magnetic moment, which is denoted by small m here. This m is the multiplication of pole strength and length. And this atomic magnet of magnetic moment m enters the non-uniform magnetic field B with a speed v along x-axis. But as we are considering the non-uniform magnetic field, means if one pole is at the magnetic field B, then other pole will be at different magnetic field, because there is a variation in magnetic field. It is not constant everywhere. But question is, if the magnetic field at one pole is B, then what will be the magnetic field at other pole? See here. Let us try to understand it from figure. See here. This is a magnetic dipole. This one. this one is the magnetic dipole. Okay, and again see the figure, this is the magnetic dipole, its length is L, and this dipole is at an angle theta from the direction of magnetic field. Here this pole, one pole is here, other pole is here. You may understand it clearly. One pole is here and other pole is here. This pole, you may see magnetic field is B, and this pole, you may see magnetic field is B plus dV by dz L cos theta. Don't confuse. And you may understand how B plus, because as I told you, from this to this, when you go from one pole to another pole along the length, the magnetic field varies. But at what rate? Suppose dB by dz is the rate of variation. Then we move from this pole to this pole. Perpendicular movement is L cos theta. So it will be PB plus dB by dz L cos theta. What is P? Again, I am saying P is the pole strength. And what is L? L is the length of the magnet. And here, I am coming to the point. Here, del B by del z. You may see here, del B by del z. It is the variation rate of change of magnetic field along z axis. And if the magnet, if atomic dipole is placed in non-uniform magnetic field, obviously there will be two forces on each pole. One force is at this pole, another force is at this pole. And these two forces are not same. Why? Because the field is not uniform. So these two, under the two different forces, it not only experiences a torque, it also experiences a linear displacement, okay, or translatory force, you may say. If due to torque, dipole will rotate and it will stay at an angle theta, then potential energy will be minus m dot b, that is mb cos theta. And the force on the atomic dipole is F is equal to del m dot b. Under this force, and if we remove this dot, we may write F is equal to m cos theta del v by del z. Why del v by del z? Because magnetic field gradient is along z direction, not along x and y. Okay. Classically, theta can have all possible value. Here, see, classically means according to classical mechanics, the orientation is not fixed. It may orient itself in any of the direction from 0 to 180. From figure you may see here. One orientation is this side, another orientation is this side, third orientation this side, and this side. So different orientation. But when this atomic magnet passes through this magnetic field, then you can see this is the result. You can see that all the dipoles having orientation in one direction, upside comes one side, come one side, and having another orientation go to opposite place. So one, we get two lines here, two spots here. One is if for spin up, another is for spin down. It confirms that spin has two orientation. This is from quantum point of view. Okay, and this is from classical point of view. This one. These two figures, side by side, you can see these. There are two figures. These two figures, if you are not interested, you may or may not draw in the examination. Not necessary, but this figure is necessary. Come here. I'm coming to the figure. This figure is necessary to draw in the examination. What is the experimental part here? So I am returning to here. As I told you, this is the force, and if m0 is the mass of the atomic dipole, then acceleration will be A equal to force by mass. Here m0 is the mass of silver atom, or you may say atomic magnet. Suppose length of the path of the beam through the magnetic field is capital L, this one. Then time taken to travel through the field, time is equal to distance upon, means length upon speed. So displacement along deflection, deviation, deflection, whatever you may say, d is equal to half acceleration t square. Acceleration is equal to force by mass. Okay. And t is equal to L by B. So t square is equal to L square by B square. Here putting the value of F, we get this one. And with this result, we can see that theta is equal to two possibility. Theta is, has two possibility. One is plus one, another is minus. So deviation on two sides. And thus Stern-Gerlach experiment provides a satisfactory experimental evidence of the Gaud and Smith-Uhlenbeck hypothesis of space quantization. Actually, the experiment Stern and Gerlach performed, did the experiment in 1922, and Uhlenbeck and Gaud Smith in 1925 told about space quantization. So Stern-Gerlach experiment provides a satisfactory experimental evidence of Gaud-Smith and Uhlenbeck hypothesis of space quantization. So, and now in the at last we want to discuss about experimental part. This is electric oven, this one. Here silver atom is situated and it is heated. When silver atom is heated, it melts, evaporates, and the vapor of silver in the form of atomic beam comes out from the oven and collimated through two slits. These are the two slits, S1 and S2. Its purpose of the slits are to collimate the atomic beam. Okay. And this collimated atomic beam passes through magnetic field. As I told you, that magnetic field is not uniform from here to here. This one. Non-uniform magnetic field. Non-uniform magnetic field produced by taking a special type of magnet whose one pole is knife edge shape and another pole has channel, this one. Okay, so you may see one pole S, this is S pole which has a channel, and this is N pole which has a knife edge, and purpose to create non-uniform magnetic field. You may see here N to S. These are the lines of magnetic lines of force, and you may see these are not parallel, so you can say that the magnetic field is not constant. These are in curve, so non-uniform. And when it is passed through non-uniform magnetic field, there are two cases. If the field is on, you will get only one line. We get only one line as we expect, because classical point of view, when the magnetic field is not there, all orientations are possible. So there is no question of dividing up. Instead, we will get a straight line. Okay. I am reading here, when there is no magnetic, this is the main part, when there is no magnetic field, a thin straight line trace was obtained on the glass plate. This is the glass plate which acts as a screen, this one. This is a glass plate which acts as a screen. So you may write here a screen or photographic plate. Based on classical theory, we should see a continuous spectrum. Why continuous? Because electrons can have magnetic dipole moment oriented along all possible directions. So you have to understand this sentence. From classical point of view, electron can have magnetic dipole moment in all possible directions. On applying the field, but when the field is applied, situation changes. What change we get? The beam was found to split up into two components, one on either side of the original line, indicating that just two possible orientation of the magnetic moment of the electron. The trace of silver particles now consisted of two lines except at ends means here. Here they are not separated because it indicates that field is very weak. And these two lines on the glass plate confirms the spin of electron means space quantization. I hope you have understood this video. So thank you.